Jesus not only being our Savior, but our King, and we are following His lead, His rule in His kingdom. That's the upward. But then we begin to kind of look inward at who we are as the body of Christ, and look at that inward look, which means to look at one another because we are connected. We are part of His body, we're called to live in relationship. And then last week, we begin to shift our gaze outward. We begin to look outward of God's mission. And I shared with you these words. I believe that Jesus came on purpose for a purpose. He came on purpose for a purpose. Jesus' purpose in His earthly life was to seek and to save that which is lost. He came to introduce us to the reality of God's kingdom. I really believe that He introduced it, but He challenged us as His followers to pray. Part of His body, I challenged you last week with these words that we are called now to live on purpose for His purpose. We are His hands, we are His feet. We have the privilege of being His voice in the world today, in part. So that means that we are a part of His purpose in His mission. Today, I'm going to drill down a little bit deeper than what it means, not only personally, but corporately, as His body, to live for His purpose, to live on mission for God. I believe that Scriptures teach us that His call to be on mission is not simply a call to just go broadly proclaim the message of Jesus to the world. That is part. We are called to share the message of the gospel. But His word also makes it clear, and we talked about this a little bit last week, that we are called to be disciple makers, to make disciples. That call to be a disciple maker implies relationship. You can't be a disciple maker if you only fly at 30,000 feet and you lob a few things down on the ground about Jesus. You can only be a disciple maker if you engage with one-on-one groups of some kind or another, which is in part why I called you and challenging you to participate in this 40 days of discipleship school. Because it is a relationship with one another, we grow best. All of us today, all of us in this room, everybody watching online today, we all know at least one person who is outside of God's family. We just do. It could be your neighbor, it could be someone in your family, it could be a co-worker, it could be someone that you see at the grocery store and check out and say. But all of us know at least one person outside of a relationship with Jesus. And God is calling you and I individually, He is calling us as a church to be on the lookout for and to engage with those people. To be ready and willing at any moment of the day to share the truth, the hope, and the love of Jesus with someone outside of this family. And that's what we're going to truly live on today. Now, when it comes to finding text in the scripture that is the kind of definitive text, that fully unpacks what this looks like, you're not going to find it. We need to find a way through a variety of scriptures to better understand this. So we're going to explore a number of them today in regards to this focus. And we're going to begin by talking about shared this with you last week in part, but we're going to revisit again today. God's heart for the world is redemption and restoration. It is so much His heart that it is a part of the work of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. All are engaged in bringing redemption and restoration to the world. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, we hear these words: God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to eternal life. God's heart is that there is not a single person that would leave this earthly life without coming into a relationship with Him. He wants every person to come to faith, to experience a life-transforming, life-giving relationship with Him. That's His heart. We talked about Jesus' mission to seek and save that which is lost. He became sin, the Scripture said. He knew no sin. Why? So that you and I might become the righteousness of God. You see, God's Spirit wants to transform every Christ follower to become more and more and more like Christ. It's a graphic I'm going to have for us up on the screen. It's the graphic for next month's sermon series. In February, we're going to start a sermon series taken from the book of Galatians, chapter 5, through the Spirit. It is God's heart that as we enter into relationship with Him, that our heart might love. So, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control become more and more and more evident in your life. Why? Because redemption and restoration lies in the heart. Come on. As we think about, as we talk about the heart of God, we need to dig a little bit deeper then to see what that heart does. What does love do? We talk about God's heart. What does love do? Love, in God's eyes, is the actions of His heart. Many of you, most of you, perhaps in this room, have memorized John 3:16. So we say, what does love do? For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son. What does love do? Love. Talk about another passage of Scripture that we looked at back in December during the Christmas season. John chapter 1, verse 14, and the Word became flesh. He told us, what does love do? Love does it sit so where it falls. Love declares it, steps into the world. I love how Eugene Peterson paraphrases this verse in his paraphrase of the message. He says that the Word became flesh and blood. You can't talk about the heart of God, you can't talk about the love of God, and dismiss the fact that God Himself is a part of human flesh. He lives with us. But there is another passage of Scripture that I want to take you to now, formally go with me to the book of Philippians in the New Testament. This is part of Paul's letters to the church. There's Galatians, Ephesians, and you have Philippians. We're going to go to chapter 2. Drill down even more on this love of God and what it knows. Philippians chapter 2, I'm going to begin reading in verse 5. Paul says this, he's talking to the church, he says, have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. Pay attention to the following words. Although He existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but He emptied Himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of man. He found in appearance as a man, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even to death on the cross. We talk about God's heart. We talk about what worship of all of the heavenly creatures. He willingly lays that aside. He is God himself, yet he lays that aside to take on the form of a human being. And not just any human being. The text says that Jesus takes on the form of a servant. What is the heart of God willing to do for you and I? Jesus humbles himself. How does Jesus humble himself? Jesus is the God of all creation. Scripture tells us that all things came into being by him, and all things are for him, and all things are upheld by him. Jesus needs nothing, but Jesus sustains everything. When Jesus came to earth, he needs that also. Jesus instead is born into poverty. He's born in a lowly manger. He is born in one of the most obscure towns there in Palestine, the town of Bethlehem. Jesus is willing to humble himself. Why? Because he cares for you. The text says that he humbles himself because he's obedient. Jesus is obedient to the Father's command. Scripture in the New Testament tells us that Jesus is without sin, which means that Jesus fully and completely obeyed all the requirements of the law. Jesus willingly took on that obedience and lived a sinless life. But not only that, Jesus is completely obedient to the Father's will. On the night that he is betrayed there in the garden, he prays to his Father three different times. Is this cup compassion? Excuse me, compassion. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Jesus willingly humbled himself and became obedient to the Father's will. And that obedience plays itself out, as it says in the text, even to death. Most of all of punishments in Jesus' day is crucifixion. What does love do? Love is willing to set the priest be obedient even to death. Death, cross. Now, why do I take time to point out this text to you? Matters are a great Bible commentator from Jesus passes this. The cross shows that there is no limit. God will do to demonstrate his love and save the world. What must sin have been? conditions. I can't expect fish to show up in my garage and know it's jump into my lap when I reclaim the position. Fishing for men implies that we must go somewhere. We must do something. Jesus did. Gospel chapter 5, Jesus says to us, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. And I love the way Eugene Peterson paraphrases this text in Matthew's Gospel. He says this about this text: God is not a secret to be kept. We are going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under a public. I'm putting you on a light stand. And now that I've put you there on a hilltop on a light stand, shine. That is your role. That is my role. We have been sent on a mission to be called to shine. We are called to be salt. We go to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 18, and text me on that, or 28, and text me on that last week. Jesus says, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Therefore, go and make disciples. First chapter. Jesus is raising from the grave. He is speaking to his followers. He says to them, you are to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. You and I, we are sent on mission to be his witnesses. And Jesus says that's going to take you to places that are far away, places that are near. It's going to take the people of all kinds to share something. Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20 says this way, we are called to be Christ's ambassadors. If the President of the United States were to call up PJ today and say, PJ, I want you to be the ambassador to Wisconsin. And PJ says, great, thanks, I'd love to do it. Can I stay in my own house? The answer to that question is no. When you're called to be an ambassador to a foreign country, you don't. So those are the kinds of things that God calls us to, that we have to be honest enough and ask ourselves, are we going? If Jesus says, I am sending you, we have to ask ourselves, are we willing to do go where Jesus says we have to go? A number of years ago, there was a Christian song by the Catholic Church. Song is this, if we are body, why aren't his arms preaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? If we are the body, why aren't our feet going? Why is his love not showing? There is way. Are you and I go? So finish that with those questions. Now there are a lot of things that perhaps arise up in your heart and your mind. Become reasons why we are at least hesitant, or they become excuses why we are unwilling to go. And some of them are simple misunderstandings. If we understand this mission of God as some kind of program or event, some kind of formal kind of experience, then it's easy to believe that to go takes way too much time. My schedule is already really full. I don't have any time to go on a mission to God. There is a place for planned effort in going. There is a place for things like a willing reason. There is a place for those things. But the call to go is not limited to those kinds of things. When Jesus calls you and I to be salt and light, he is not speaking of a planned event. He is speaking of a way of life for us. When he says, go into all the world and make disciples, you know this, that the word go means as you are going, meaning in the day-to-day stuff of life, go as Jesus' witnesses. Another misunderstanding that we sometimes have to keep us from going is that we think that we have to know X amount of stuff before we can go. they did not have this. Yes, there were Old Testament scriptures, but none of the New Testament had been written yet. And if you know anything about the culture of the day and time in which Jesus ministered and his disciples began to serve in the life of the church, the education level of the average person did not allow them to even read the Old Testament scriptures. It's not a matter of do you know enough of the Bible for you to be able to use that commission. I believe that God, just as he did in the New Testament church in the book of Acts, God will empower you by the Spirit, giving the words he said. He will help you and have conversations with people where you will share about Jesus. But I also want to say to you that I understand that there perhaps needs to be some equipping to help you do that. So this Wednesday and the following Wednesday, during our Wednesday night Bible study time, I'm going to pour in those two sessions on some things to help better equip you to share your faith with people outside of the relationship with Jesus. I would encourage you, even if you've never come on Wednesday night, I would encourage you to come. We're going to talk about a variety of different things that will help you better engage with people about your faith. Another misunderstanding that sometimes keeps us from going is not only a misunderstanding, but it's also a fear that we have. I'll talk about that fear in this moment. This, we misunderstand, we think it's our responsibility to save people. We think it's our responsibility to save people. I'm going to tell you that it's not your responsibility to save people. It is only God's responsibility to save people. We are called to give witness, to give testimony, to plant seeds of the gospel. But Jesus himself says, no man comes to the Father unless the Father draws him. It is God's word. The Apostle Paul said it this way, I planted, Apollos watered, but it is God who gives the increase. It is God's responsibility to draw someone into saving faith, not yours. Which means that you can lay aside the fear of failing. Because some of us, we fear sharing Jesus with somebody because we fear that we're going to share Jesus with them and then they don't come to faith and then we feel like a failure. We have to lay that fear aside. We have to lay aside the misunderstanding that sharing your faith is confrontation versus conversation. We have to lay aside the misunderstanding that to share Jesus is not confrontation, it's conversation. Yes, there is a place for what we refer to as apologetics, which is to give a defense of a doctrine or a topic of theology. And there is value to being able to do that in a systematic way. But that is not the sole sign of what it means to give witness for Jesus Christ. One of the ways that we get this confused is we think that when we go to share Jesus with somebody, that we actually step into the whole Holy Spirit. And we're supposed to speak conviction to someone's life. It's not the way it works. Only the Holy Spirit brings conviction. So when we share Jesus, we have to ask ourselves, are we leading with love? Or are we leading with judgment? Are we leading with condemnation? If we lay aside that misunderstanding, we will have that engagement. There's one more fear that sometimes keeps us from going. We talked about the fear of failure. That can keep us from going, but it's up to God to grant salvation, not to you. It's up to his faithful to be witnesses. But sometimes we don't go, we don't share Jesus because we fear rejection. We fear persecution. There are people who are persecuted around the world daily because of the faith. Some of us get a little apprehensive. We feel like maybe our friend or our co-worker won't talk to us anymore if we share Jesus with them. Jesus told us that we would face resistance and is a very real possibility in the world in which we live. But Jesus also says to us that blessed are you when men revile you because of me. There is blessing in being faithful even in the faith or in the persecution of the gospel of faith. That's why the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 1 says, I am not ashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God over salvation. Who we go unashamed because of Christ. So I'm going to come back to this question that's a part of our theme. This four-to-one theme. What are you, what are actually say these words. They are sobering words to me. I pray that they might be sobering words to you. He was talking about his Jewish brothers and sisters, and they were not yet coming to the faith. Paul was incredibly burdened by that. And he says these words, I am willing to be cut off so that you can be graduated. What Paul is saying is, I am willing to give up my saving relationship with God and His Son, Jesus Christ, if by giving that up means that you can come to faith. He was willing to give up eternal life with the Father, the Son, and the Spirit in heaven, if it didn't so much as you know, he doesn't. Paul says, you know what? I am willing to do whatever it takes to see somebody in the faith. What do you want to do the same? It's a matter of our heart. It's a matter of a sense of urgency. We have to examine those things in us. Will we allow our heart to pray for what breaks God's heart? Does your heart pray for what breaks God's heart when you see people in the world around you, people in your family who are outside of God's saving relationship? Does it break your heart? Or has your heart become cold and callous? And you just wonder, are you like those people in the story of the man who is injured there? And the priest and the Levites, they come and they see him injured there, but they pass by on the other side of him. Or will you be like a good Samaritan and give yourself to that person who you killed? Our heart, does our heart break what breaks God's heart? How much do we love other people? How much do we care about their eternal destiny? I know one of our Sunday school teachers for adults has used this phrase on numerous occasions. We perhaps actually hate somebody because we don't share the gospel. Do we really love those outside of God's family and love them enough that we are willing to share our faith with them? No, I'm not trying to shame you. I'm not trying to make you feel guilty. But I want us to be honest and ask these questions. If we are to be God's church, if we are to be His body, you and I cannot be content with so what does love then compel you to do? What does love compel us to do as a church? I'm going to give you some practical steps as I get towards the end of my message today. What are some practical things that love should compel you to do today and in the days ahead of the world? Here's something I think all of us need. Things. We need to pray and ask the Lord, and I need to pray and ask the Lord about our heart, about our attitude towards those outside of the family of God. Does our heart break? And if it does not, then we need to pray and ask God to have our heart break for us this morning. But there's a second way that you can pray. Pray for some divine opportunities, and then your eyes would be open to those divine opportunities. Jesus taught us in Matthew's Gospel in chapter 9, he says this, look, lift up your eyes, look around the field, it is white under the harvest. Will you pray that God would open your eyes to the harvest of souls that might be around you, in your family, in your neighborhood, in your workplace, in the marketplace? Would you pray that God would open your eyes? But not only that, Jesus says, pray to the Lord of the harvest that He would send workers into the field. Would you pray for your church family? Would you pray for your pastor that He would actively step into the harvest field that God has before us? Right? It's an important thing that you can do. It's what God should do. Here's the second thing that you can do. It's a part of praying. Ask God to give you a spirit of invitation. A spirit of invitation. When you leave the church, either through this door or through that door, there will be a display that has blue invite cards. All of us can take that simple blue card and give it to someone and invite them to church. Invite them to a men's breakfast for the ladies. Invite them to a refresh in a couple weeks. All of us can display a spirit of invitation. religious leaders get upset because Jesus is dining with tax collectors and sinners. But Matthew has a spirit of invitation. He wants other people to experience in Jesus what he has found. Do you have a spirit of invitation today? When was the last time you invited someone to church? When was the last time you invited someone to church? And not just your family member who used to come, but now they live a couple times away. When was the last time you invited someone else? Church, I'm not saying don't invite your family. Please don't hear me incorrectly. When was the last time do we have a spirit of invitation? Another practical step that you and I can make if we can answer this call. And that's simply this: make a move. Move. Go. Do something. Take a risk. And maybe that risk is simply to walk across the room in your home to a family member who has not had a relationship with Jesus. Have a conversation about it. Maybe it's to walk across the hallway at work to a coworker in another office. Share Jesus with them. Maybe it's to walk across your yard to your neighbor. Talk about Jesus to invite them to church. Maybe it's to walk across the street. Where God may be calling you to make a move. I believe he's calling you to make a move. We have to ask ourselves, are we willing to make that sacrifice of time, comfort? Are we willing to risk being rejected by one of your most loved? Are we willing to invest ourselves in relationship? I said to be a disciple maker implies relationship. Are you willing to invest yourself in the life of someone else and then come to a sacred relationship with Jesus Christ? Takes time. There's another practical step that I believe God calls to. It's simply this: be willing to share your story. Be willing to share your story, or at least some part of your story. I know this connected a little bit to this fear of not knowing enough, but you know what? God has done incredible things in your life. And whether you can cite Bible verses and chapters and books of the Bible to go with that is less the issue. So how do I know that to be true? Apostle John, in his letter to the church, 1 John chapter 1, he says this: that which we have seen, tasted and handled concerning this wonderful life. John doesn't say that which I read about in Ephesians chapter 4, or that which I read about in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, but he says that which we have seen, tasted and handled, that which we have experienced, encountered in our relationship with Jesus. This is important to you. You have a story to tell because of what Jesus has done. Another passage from Jesus' ministry is from Paul's Gospel, Mark chapter 5. Jesus is out doing ministry and he comes in contact with man who's been demon-possessed. And so we know the story. And Jesus casts out the demons from this man's life and he allows the demons to go into a herd of pigs and they rush off down the hill into the lake and they are drowned. And this man is healed. He's made whole again. Pick up the text in verse 14. As the keeper of the swine, they see all this happen, it makes them afraid, and they run away to the city and they report what has happened. And then the crowd comes out. Verse 15 of Mark chapter 5. And they came to Jesus and they observed the man who had been demon possessed sitting down, clothed in his right mind. The very man who had the legion, and they became frightened. Those who had seen it described to them how it had happened. The demon-possessed man who had been praying. They began to implore Jesus to leave their reason, their afraid. As he was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed was imploring Jesus that he might come with him. Listen to what Jesus says. And he did not let him. But he said to them, go home to your people and report to them what great things the Lord has done for you. Now he is at mercy. Mercy and restore. Don't tell someone your story. It's my challenge to us. All of us can do that. It's a very simple thing. Author Cindy Steiner Ray says that the disciples shared their stories is counting back. And for every man in this room or watching online today who loves Jesus, to begin to talk about him to their friends, just to tell them what he has done. You, I, have a circle of friends. Will we go to talk about Jesus? What are we? Here's the first next step that I want to ask you to think about. We'll do more with this in some days to come. But here, just in the quietness of this room today, would you allow God to surface in your heart and your spirit the name of at least one person that you know? I'm going to tell you mine today. I'm actually going to give you three names. Jim and Ruth, because they live right next to me. And Dan, that's two houses down. Today, would you make a fresh commitment to begin to pray regularly that God would prepare and lead your heart to share with them, that God would prepare and draw their heart to the gospel? And either today or in the next couple weeks, would you share with at least one other person the name of your one? And would you invite them to pray with you that God would use you to share Jesus with them? So I am inviting you as your pastor to hold me accountable. When you see me, whether it's this week, next month, you have the freedom, church, to come to me and say, Pastor John, have you had the opportunity to share with Jim and Ruth? Have you had the opportunity to share with Dan? Why? Because this is our mission. God is calling us to go. Will you share that with at least one other person and ask them to come in? Pray. Help me to be accountable. And would you join me in one more house? Would you join me in praying that God would send us out of our hearts? That in 2023, God would do incredible things in the life of our city and the life of our county as God's step. God, would you stir our hearts today? Lord, where you need to bring conviction to my life or anyone else in this room, God, would you bring conviction? Lord, where we have perhaps been reluctant to step into the mission that you have called us to be your witnesses, to be your ambassadors, to be salt and light, to be disciple makers, to be fishers. Lord, would you help us to play our part? Whatever part that is, Lord, would we be obedient to your call today? Lord, help us to be with you, just as you were to empty yourself. We are humbly obedient to the Father's will. So the Father's right now. Save me, Lord Jesus. That's all we say to you. Would you remain standing in the same place?